Welcome to this lecture series on Environment and Ecology presented by Mentors for IS in association with Bangalore IS Academy and Nama KPSC. So this is to inform you that this is actually an initiative of Nama KPSC to help students to prepare and study from home with the help of YouTube videos, current affairs which are available on the website, PDF materials which are available for every subject, and also online tests to track your preparation. So do remember to visit www.namakpsc.com for more information. Now, in this particular session, continuing with our lecture series with respect to environment and ecology, we will be discussing about air pollution. Now, this is actually a very common topic as well as one of the most important topics when it comes to your current affairs. So what I would request you to do is do read your newspapers, do update yourself when it comes to air pollution, and not just air pollution, any kind of pollution which is going to affect our environment as well as ecology. Now, first is air pollution. Now, I'm pretty sure everybody understands what is air pollution. Air pollution refers to the presence of undesirable impurities or the abnormal rise in the proportion or concentration of some constituents in the atmosphere. This air pollution can be defined as an alteration of air quality that can be characterized by measurements of chemical, biological, or physical pollutants in the air. This is nothing but alteration of air quality that can be characterized by measurements of chemical, biological, and physical constituents in the air. This air pollution can also be visible, such as smoke or smog, obviously, which everybody can determine, or air pollution can also be invisible, such as the release of carbon monoxide or sulfur oxides into the atmosphere. This air pollution can also be classified depending upon its extent as local level, regional level, or global level. So if air pollution is said to be affecting at a local level, it could be smoke, for example, which affects the quality of ambient air within a radius of a few kilometers. If air pollution is regional, then it could be acid rain, for example, or photochemical reactions which can extend up to a few thousand kilometers. Similarly, air pollution can also affect and act at a global level, such as global warming or ozone layer depletion, which affects humans, not only humans, but actually the entire ecology itself at a global scale or at a global level. So this is nothing but what air pollution is and how we can classify air pollution to be affecting the environment and the ecology at the local level, regional level, as well as the global level. Next, moving on to the other question, that is, what are the causes of air pollution? What are air pollution causes? Now, air pollution is caused by the presence of toxic substances in the atmosphere, mainly produced by human activities, which depletes the air qualities. So some of the major anthropogenic sources of air pollution are: one, you could take it as the main important source, that is the combustion of fossil fuels. So combustion of fossil fuels like coal and oil for electricity and for road transportation, which produces air pollutants like nitrogen oxides or sulfur oxides, these all cause air pollution. Second, we could take the emissions from industries and factories. Emissions from industries and factories are also one of the major causes of air pollution. These emissions from industries and factories, which release a large amount of carbon monoxide, hydrogen carbons, and organic compounds into the air, also cause air pollution. Third, we can consider agricultural activities. Agricultural activities due to the use of pesticides, insecticides, and fertilizers that emit harmful chemicals into the atmosphere also cause or also result in air pollution. And finally, we can consider waste production. Waste production mostly because of methane generation in landfills. So all these things are one of the major causes of air pollution. It is not restricted, it is not exclusive, but these are the major causes of air pollution across the world. So one, you could consider the combustion of fossil fuels, the emission from industries and factories, agricultural activities, which will also include livestock, and also waste management or the production of waste itself. However, I want you to remember that air pollution can also be caused by some natural phenomena like volcanic eruptions, wildfires, or dust storms, and it is not restricted only to anthropogenic activities, and air pollution can also be caused by natural phenomena. Now, this air pollution, as we all know, will have great consequences on the environment. So it can result in global warming and can also affect human health. So next, what we will be discussing about is what are the effects of air pollution? What are some of the effects of air pollution? So we will be classifying the effects of air pollution into two major categories. That is, one, the effect on the environment, and how air pollution can also result in global warming. Now, the effects of air pollution, that is on the environment. This air pollution can have a major impact. So I'm discussing about the environment, how air pollution affects environment. So air pollution can have a major impact on the process of plant evolution by preventing photosynthesis with serious consequences for the purification of air that we breathe. This air pollution can also contribute to the release of pollutants, which may change the rainfall pattern. So the air pollutants which are released may also fall back to earth and contaminate the surface bodies of water and soil. Meaning, air pollution can also result in water pollution and soil pollution. It can also kill crops or reduce their yield. This in turn will affect the economy as well. If the crop yield comes down, the economy of a country may also be affected. The sulfur dioxide and nitrogen oxide that are released into the atmosphere can create acid rain, which when mixed with water and oxygen in the atmosphere, this is when you get acid rain. This is when acid rain falls to earth. And when you have acid rain, it will damage plants. It can change the soil composition. It will degrade water quality. It will damage crops, cause buildings and monuments to decay as well, and also affect humans. So these are the effects of air pollution when we consider it in terms of how the environment itself is affected. Then we will move on to how air pollution can lead to global warming. Now, air pollution obviously is also a major contributor to global warming and climate change due to the abundance of greenhouse gases, especially carbon dioxide, which is emitted into the atmosphere by burning of fossil fuels. Other gases may be emitted by natural and artificial sources like methane from coal, plants, and agricultural processes. Nitrogen oxides, that is NOx, from industrial factories, agriculture, and burning of fossil fuels. You can have fluorinated gases such as hydrofluorocarbons, that is your HFCs, which are emitted by industries. See, worldwide, many countries have taken steps to combat emissions, and at the international level, we have the Kyoto Protocol, which is aimed at reducing carbon dioxide emissions. But all these measures that have taken, even this international measure, that is the Kyoto Protocol, is not sufficient. It is not going to suffice in our fight to control air pollution, climate change, or global warming. And actions need to be taken not just at the international level, but also at an individual level. So, discussing about air pollution itself. So you have to understand that people experience a wide range of health effects due to this air pollution. It can be due to being exposed to air pollution itself. So the health effects on humans due to air pollution can be short term or long term. That is, the effects of air pollution on humans can be short term or long term. Short-term effects are temporary and could include illnesses such as pneumonia or bronchitis. It could have short-term effects such as pneumonia or bronchitis. Also, irritation to the nose, throat, eyes or skin. These are all short-term effects. Similarly, we can have long-term effects that can range from respiratory diseases to heart diseases and lung cancer. So, some scientists also believe that air pollution can cause birth defects. So, these are some of the effects of air pollution on human health. So, apart from the effects of air pollution on the environment and global warming, you can also make note of how air pollution affects human health. Next, how can air pollution be prevented? This air pollution can be prevented by several ways. Okay, again, not exclusive, but these are some of the ways how air pollution can be prevented. The best way, one of the most important way, is nothing but renewable energy and clean energy. So, you can make use of renewable fuel and clean energy. The most basic solution for air pollution is to move away from fossil fuels and replace them with alternative energies like solar, wind, geothermal, etc., etc., which I'm sure everybody knows. Second is energy conservation and efficiency. So, apart from producing clean energy, it is also important to reduce energy consumption and improve energy efficiency. Third, we could consider eco-friendly transportation. So, obviously, when it comes to eco-friendly transportation, we could consider shifting to electric vehicles and hydrogen vehicles or promote public transport. Now, these are all obviously very common solutions which everybody should know, everybody should be able to incorporate and bring out when it comes to writing such answers for your mains. And finally, one of the most important, because construction activities are also considered to contribute a lot to air pollution, we need to inculcate green building. So, green building is what? From planning to demolition, green building aims to create environmentally responsible structures to reduce carbon footprint. This is nothing but green building. So here I want you to further, this is as part of your homework, I would request you to please understand, read more about what green building is. Now, green building will once again be a major or one of the most important activities in order to prevent or reduce air pollution, because construction activities, as we see this construction boom in our cities, also leads to more and more air pollution. So, this is how, these are some of the ways as to how we can reduce air pollution and what are the activities that can be taken up in order to produce, in order to reduce air pollution. Next, we will briefly discuss about some of the major air pollutants. So, I have here listed some of the major air pollutants. We'll just briefly discuss about some of the major air pollutants. What are they? How do they affect us? So, the first major air pollutant that I've mentioned here is carbon monoxide. Now, carbon monoxide is a colorless, odorless gas that is produced by the incomplete burning of carbon-based fuels, including your petrol, diesel, and wood. So, carbon monoxide is produced due to incomplete combustion of carbon-based fuel. If it is completely combusted, obviously you can have carbon dioxide. Now, coming back to carbon monoxide itself, it is also produced from the combustion of natural and synthetic products such as cigarettes. So, cigarettes can also release carbon monoxide. Smoking can also cause air pollution. So, this carbon monoxide, how does this affect health? Carbon monoxide lowers the amount of oxygen that enters our blood and can slow our reflexes and make us confused and sleepy. So, if you breathe in carbon monoxide, it reduces the ability of blood to carry oxygen. It will reduce our reflex system. It will bring down our reflex system, making people confused and sleepy. Therefore, carbon monoxide also affects health. Second, we move over to carbon dioxide. Now, carbon dioxide is very simple. Everybody understands what is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is nothing but the principal greenhouse gas which is emitted as a result of human activity such as burning of coal, oil and natural gas. Now, this is a very important greenhouse gas which leads to global warming. Now, carbon dioxide does not affect as a pollutant itself, but its increase in concentration is causing global warming. This in turn can have disastrous effects on the planet. Therefore, carbon dioxide emission can also be harmful for us. Next, CFCs, that is your chlorofluorocarbons. Now, CFCs are, these are nothing but gases that are released mainly from air conditioning systems and refrigeration, because it is used as your, it is used in your cooling systems. Now, when CFCs are released into the air, CFCs rise to the stratosphere where they come in contact with few other gases, which lead to a reduction of the ozone layer that protects the earth from harmful ultraviolet rays of the sun. So this concept of ozone layer depletion, ozone hole that you hear about, all of this is nothing but due to CFC. Now CFC is emitted nothing but due to human activities, and this is causing a great deal of effect, a great deal of damage to the ozone layer, which is important to be which is important for life on earth, because it is the ozone layer which protects life on earth from the harmful ultraviolet rays. Next, lead. This lead which is released into the atmosphere is the lead which is present in petrol, diesel, lead batteries, paints or other dye products. The lead which is released is especially harmful to children in particular, because it can cause nervous system damage and digestive problems, and in some cases can also lead to cancer. Therefore, the lead which is present in many of the in your fossil fuels and paints, the paints which are used to paint the interior of your homes, if it contains lead, can have harmful effects on children present at homes. Therefore, lead can also be released into the atmosphere, and if it is released into the atmosphere, it can once again cause major or serious problems. Next, we move over to the other major air pollutant, that is ozone. Now, ozone naturally occurs in the upper layers of the atmosphere. This is obviously the important gas which shields the earth from harmful ultraviolet rays of the sun. However, when ozone is produced at the ground level, it is a pollutant with highly toxic effects. So, vehicles and industries are actually the major source of ground level ozone emissions. So, when ozone is produced and if a person is exposed to ozone, his eyes might itch. You may have burning sensation and watering, and it can also lead to a resistance level being brought down. So if a person is exposed to ozone, it lowers the resistance to cold and pneumonia. So if ozone is present at the lower level, closer to the ground, it can be harmful. However, in the stratosphere, it protects us from ultraviolet rays. Next is your nitrogen oxide. Now, nitrogen oxide causes smog and acid rain. These are the major effects. How does nitrogen oxide cause problem in the environment? It is especially through smog and acid rain. Now these are small points which are important, from which statements may be formed for your prelims. So all these things you have to make note of, because you must know that nitrogen oxide causes smog and acid rain. Now carbon dioxide is not going to cause smog as such. So these are such small points that you should understand, because it is from these points that your questions will be framed in your prelims. Now, coming back to nitrogen oxide causes smog and acid rain, and it is produced from burning of fossil fuels, again burning of fossil fuels such as petrol, diesel and coal. Nitrogen oxide can also make children susceptible to respiratory diseases in winter time. It can also lead to respiratory diseases. Next, moving over to suspended particulate matter. Now, suspended particulate matter is nothing but small solids in the air in the form of smoke, dust and vapor that can remain suspended for extended periods. This is nothing but particulate matter which remains suspended in air for extended periods, and is also the main source of haze which reduces visibility. So when you have very fine particles suspended in air, and when humans breathe in this very fine particles, these particles may get lodged in the lungs and can also cause lung damage and once again respiratory problems. It can once again cause respiratory problems. Next, you have sulfur dioxide. Now, sulfur dioxide is a gas which is produced from burning coal, mainly in thermal power plants. Some industrial processes, such as production of paper and smelting of metals, also produce sulfur dioxide. And once again, apart from nitrogen oxide, sulfur dioxide is one such gas which also contributes to smog and acid rain and also causes respiratory diseases like nitrogen oxide. So, once again, please remember sulfur dioxide is also responsible for smog, acid rain, and respiratory diseases. Okay, next we have fly ash. Now, a question on fly ash has already been asked in UPSC, so it is unlikely that you might get a question in the very near future, but you never know. So it is best to just discuss about fly ash quickly. So this fly ash is nothing but ash which is produced whenever you combust solid material. Fly ash is produced whenever combustion of solid material takes place. So fly ash is one such residue which rises with the gases into the atmosphere, and it is nothing but a very fine powder which tends to travel far in the air. So this ash does not rise as is termed as when it comes to bottom ash. You have to remember that the ash which does not rise is termed as bottom ash, whereas the ash which rises up into the atmosphere and moves along with air is known as fly ash. Bottom ash is ash which does not rise up. The ash which rises up along with air is known as fly ash. So, what is the composition of this fly ash? Composition, that is the components which make up fly ash are, one is aluminium silicate. That is a major constituent element of fly ash. Fly ash is majorly made up of aluminium silicate. It can also have silicon dioxide and calcium oxide. Aluminium silicate, silicon dioxide, and calcium oxide. These are the major constituent elements of fly ash. Apart from that, fly ash particles are oxide rich and consist of silica, alumina, oxides of iron. It can have calcium, magnesium, toxic heavy metals like lead, arsenic, cobalt, and copper. So, therefore, it is actually important to prevent the escape of this ash into the atmosphere. So, whenever you have combustion of solid materials, fly ash may be generated. And therefore, it is important for us to prevent it from entering into the atmosphere and collect this fly ash. So, whenever you have fly ash which is generated, fly ash must be captured by electrostatic precipitators or other particle filtration equipments before the flue gases reach the chimneys of coal-fired power plants. Now, obviously, in India, one of the major sources of energy or power is nothing but coal. So, when you have thermal power plants where coal is combusted to produce heat energy, a lot of fly ash is generated. This fly ash should be prevented from entering into the atmosphere before it is released through the chimneys into the atmosphere, and therefore it must be captured by making use of electrostatic precipitators or other particle filtration equipments. So, the reason we are discussing about fly ash is because fly ash, once again, as I've already explained, can have environmental effects. If this fly ash is not captured and disposed of properly, it can pollute air and water considerably. It can also cause respiratory problems. And if fly ash in the air remains in air for a long time, over a period of time, it will slowly settle down on leaves and crops in fields nearby, closer to those thermal power plants, and can also bring down plant yield or crop yield, and therefore can also affect agricultural activities. However, this fly ash, if caught before it is released into the atmosphere, can have certain advantages. So, the advantages of fly ash is that cement can be replaced by fly ash up to 35%, thus reducing the cost of construction or making roads. So this is one of the major advantages of fly ash. The major advantage of fly ash is that cement can be replaced by fly ash up to 35%, thereby reducing the cost of construction and also making roads, meaning cement can be replaced with fly ash. So you can also make fly ash bricks, which are light in weight and offer high strength and durability. So apart from being a byproduct of energy generation, that is combustion of fossil fuels, this fly ash can be used in construction activities by making fly ash bricks. Now, the reason fly ash is advantageous is because fly ash is a better filling material for road embankments and also in concrete roads. So if you are considering to making better roads, then fly ash can be used in construction of concrete roads. Fly ash can also be used in reclamation of wastelands. Abandoned mines can be filled up with fly ash, and fly ash can also increase the crop yield and enhance water holding capacity of the land if it is laid down along the agricultural fields. So if it is not allowed to enter into the atmosphere and if it is captured before, this fly ash can have major applications which can be beneficial to human activities. And in this effort, in order to capture fly ash and to make use of this fly ash, the Ministry of Environment and Forests, through its notification in 2009, has made it mandatory to use fly ash based products in all construction projects, road embankment works and low-lying landfilling works within 100 kilometers of radius of thermal power station. I'm going to repeat this. The Ministry of Environment and Forests, through a notification 2009, has said that within a radius of 100 kilometers of thermal power plants, the fly ash which is generated shall be used in all construction projects, road embankment works and low-lying landfilling works. Also, to use fly ash in mine filling activities within 50 kilometers of radius of thermal power stations. So this is what the Ministry of Environment and Forests has actually notified in order to make use of fly ash for advantageous works instead of being released into the atmosphere. Next, let us briefly discuss about indoor air pollution. So until now, whatever we have been discussing about is outdoor air pollution. So here we will be discussing about indoor air pollution. Now, I'm pretty sure everybody understands what is outdoor air pollution and what is indoor air pollution. Indoor air pollution refers to the physical, chemical, and biological characteristics of air in the indoor environment within a home or an institution or commercial facility. Meaning, this is air pollution within the four walls of your home, your institution, or any other commercial facility. Indoor air problems, when compared to outdoor air problems, can be very subtle and do not always produce easily recognized impacts on health. Meaning, indoor air pollution, the effects of indoor air pollution is not as visible as outdoor air pollution. When compared to outdoor air pollution, it is not very easily noticeable. And also, different conditions are responsible for indoor air pollution in rural areas and urban areas. Therefore, indoor air pollution can be classified into rural indoor air pollution as well as urban indoor air pollution. So here it is necessary that you briefly understand what is this difference between rural indoor air pollution and urban indoor air pollution. So first is your rural indoor air pollution. Now, rural indoor air pollution occurs in rural areas, and it is the rural areas that face the greatest threat from indoor air pollution, where people rely on traditional fuels such as firewood, charcoal and cow dung for cooking and heating. So all the smoke which is released within the home can cause indoor air pollution. Meaning, burning such fuels produces large amounts of smoke and other air pollutants in the confined space of the home, resulting in high exposure. Obviously, women and children are the groups most vulnerable as they spend more time indoors and are exposed to the smoke. Although many hundreds of separate chemical agents have been identified in the smoke from biofuels, the four most serious pollutants when it comes to rural indoor air pollution are particulates, carbon monoxide, polycyclic organic matter and formaldehyde. They are particulates, carbon monoxide, polycyclic organic matter and formaldehyde. These are the major pollutants when it comes to rural indoor air pollution. Formaldehyde. Next, moving over to urban indoor air pollution. Now, in urban areas, exposure to indoor air pollution has increased due to a variety of reasons, such as construction of more tightly sealed buildings. Obviously, in urban areas, we have very small buildings with very poor or reduced ventilation. This can increase the effects of urban indoor air pollution. The use of synthetic materials for building and furnishing, the use of chemical products, pesticides or household care products, all these things can cause urban air pollution. Obviously, I've mentioned about the use of paints earlier, paint which contains lead. This can also cause urban air pollution. So other than nitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide and lead, there can be a number of other pollutants that affect the air quality when it comes to urban indoor air pollution. So when it is rural pollution, it is usually due to the combustion of fuel, whereas in urban indoor pollution, it is due to the using of synthetic products which causes air pollution within homes or within institutions. So here we will briefly discuss about the different pollutants when it comes to indoor air pollution. We have already discussed the major pollutants of when it comes to outdoor air pollution. Here we will be discussing briefly about the pollutants when it comes to indoor air pollution. Okay, so the first is volatile organic compounds. Now, volatile organic compounds are one of the most important indoor air pollutants. The main indoor sources are perfumes, hair sprays, furniture polish, glues, air fresheners, or other preservatives which are used in urban areas. And this can have some types of health effects, such as irritation in the eye, nose, throat, headaches, nausea and loss of coordination. All these things can be caused by volatile organic compounds. At the same time, it can also have long-term effects such as damage to the liver and other parts of the body which are actually suspected. There's not much of research to support this, but it is actually considered that volatile organic compounds can also have long-term damage, and more research is actually required to study how indoor air pollution in urban areas especially can have adverse effects on human health. Next is tobacco. Now, smoke from tobacco generates a wide range of harmful chemicals and is considered to be carcinogenic. So once again, this smoke from tobacco can result in burning of eyes, nose and throat. It can also lead to cancer, bronchitis, asthma and also decrease lung function. And also it is not only the person who is going to smoke which is going to be affected, also others living around or living close to such persons may also be affected due to the use of tobacco. Then we have biological pollutants. Now, biological pollutants, you should understand what are biological pollutants. Now, biological pollutants includes pollen grains from plants, it could be mite or hair from pets. You can have fungi, parasites and some bacteria. Most of them are nothing but allergens and cause breathing problems. Say for example, asthma, hay fever and other allergic diseases. So usually biological pollutants will cause some kind of allergy and can also result in breathing problems due to some allergic reaction where you may have inflammation in your breathing tracts. Then we have formaldehyde. Now, formaldehyde is mainly from carpets or your particle boards or insulation foams, which can also cause irritation to the eyes, nose and throat once again. Then we have radon. Now, radon is a gas that is emitted naturally by the soil. Due to modern houses having poor ventilation, It gets confined inside the house and can cause lung cancers. So radon is maybe is naturally it may be naturally produced, but due to poor ventilation, especially in urban areas, it is once again considered to be radon, because radon is not able to easily escape, gets confined within a small space and can cause health problems as well. And obviously, asbestos and pesticides, asbestos, you may have asbestos sheets which are used in urban areas, and pesticides which are used indiscriminately, which can also cause harmful effects on human health. So these are some of the few important pollutants when it comes to indoor air pollution. Next, we will consider what some of the control measures when it comes to air pollution. Now, the most important is policy measures. Now, some of the acts which are there, some of the initiatives which have been taken by the government, I will be discussing about it in brief. But what is important is that in order to prevent air pollution, what we need is stringent acts, stringent policy measures, which will ensure that certain measures are taken in order to prevent air pollution. So policy measures, not only at the state level but national level as well as international level, is what is required as of today to prevent air pollution. So the most important is policy measures. Second, we can take up preventive measures. Now obviously I have already discussed some of the ways how air pollution can be prevented. So some policy measures can lead to certain prevention measures. Say for example, policy measures to ensure the selection of suitable fuel with lower sulfur concentration and its efficient utilization. This can be brought about through policy measures which will help in preventing air pollution. Policy measures which will bring about modifications in industrial processes or equipments to reduce emission, selection of suitable manufacturing site, zoning, for example, setting up of industries at a distance from residential areas, all these things help in preventing air pollution. And these measures for preventing air pollution can only be brought about through suitable policy measures. Next, we can consider catalytic converters. Now, these are nothing but control measures to destroy pollutants by thermal or catalytic combustion. Say, for example, if you have a catalytic converter in vehicles, these catalytic converters in vehicles can convert nitrogen oxide to nitrogen and reduce the potential hazards of nitrogen oxides. So catalytic converters, especially in vehicles, help in controlling air pollution from combustion of fossil fuels in transportation. Then we can consider controlling of gaseous pollutants. The gaseous pollutants can obviously be controlled through techniques of combustion, absorption and adsorption. Once again, this is very important, controlling gaseous pollutants. Once again, in our thermal power plants, where a lot of pollutants are directly released into the atmosphere in gaseous forms. And finally, we can consider controlling of automobile exhaust. How can this be done? This is nothing but through the use of efficient engines. We can make use of good quality automobile fuels, lead-free petrol, or shifting over to compressed natural gas. So here what I want you to do is that I want you to, if possible, if you do have time, please do read about what is this Bharat Stage 6 emission norms. So obviously I'm pretty sure everybody knows that we have shifted over from Bharat Stage 4 to Bharat Stage 6. So I will not be discussing Bharat Stage 6 here itself, but I want you to read, I want you to Google or whatever notes that you have, please do read about Bharat Stage 6. How is Bharat Stage 6 important? What does the role play? Why are we moving over from Bharat Stage 4 to 6? Why are we jumping over from Stage 4 to Stage 6 and skipping Stage 5? What are the improvements in terms of engine capacity, in terms of pollutants which are released from automobiles, in terms of fuel efficiency, or in terms of how the quality of fuel has to be improved? What are the measures to be taken? How is it going to affect the industry? All these things have to be considered, all these things have to be read and understood when it comes to your Bharat Stage 6 norms, because it is very important to control automobile exhaust and therefore air pollution, global warming as well as climate change. So this I want you to do it by yourself. Next, we'll briefly discuss about air pollution in India. air pollution in India. Now, when it comes to air pollution in India, India's air pollution is ranked among the worst in the world and is adversely impacting the lifespan of its citizens, reducing most Indians, the lives of most Indians by over 3 years, according to the World Health Organization. So air pollution, obviously, you would have read many articles, you would have come across many reports in the newspapers as to how many of our cities are highly polluted. The air pollution level is very, very high in most of our big cities, and this is severely affecting the lives of poor people, especially those people who are downtrodden, who do not have access to better qualities of life. So over half of India's population, actually 660 or over 600 million people, live in areas where fine particulate matter pollution is above India's standards. So as I said, it is affecting the lives of millions in India and thereby bringing down their lifespan itself. Also, I want you to know that India is placed as among the bottom performer on several indicators such as environmental health impact, air quality, water and sanitation, and India's environment health severely lags behind the BRICS nations when it comes to your environmental performance index. So we have something known as the environmental performance index, and when we consider the environmental performance index, India performs very poorly, and this is affecting the lives of India's citizens. So I'm pretty sure you know that how many of our cities, as I've already mentioned, are highly polluted. So what is happening is that despite the directives of the National Green Tribunal or civic agencies actually continue to allow concretization in green belts. So this is one of the serious problems what is taking place in India. So in spite of many of the measures put up by the Green Tribunal, these measures are ignored by civic agencies, and they are allowing or they are giving a go ahead or green signal, or they are turning a blind eye to the kind of concretization which is taking place in green belts, which are necessary to reduce pollution, which are necessary to bring down the level of pollution in the air. So what is happening is that this booming real estate and demand for housing units is actually leading to the change of land use and shrinkage of natural conservation zones such as forests, water bodies, wastelands, sanctuaries, or groundwater rechargeable areas. This mindless concretization of ground and green belts and booming real estate has led to something known as the heat island effect. This is once again what I want you to read through. A question has already been asked about heat island effect. I want you to once again, as part of your self-study, understand, read more about what is this heat island effect, how is this heat island effect caused, and what is this effect itself. So just a brief explanation, this is nothing but the short wave radiations which emanate from concrete surfaces at night time. So concretization actually causes heat island effect. Apart from this, concretization prevents groundwater recharge, thus depleting the green cover. When you have tall buildings, these tall buildings also block winds, thereby reducing their cooling effect. So what I'm trying to say is that the environmental crisis in India is many-sided and multifaceted, which has to be addressed on different fronts and by a variety of different actors. Therefore, it is important that we harness scientific and social scientific expertise to develop and promote eco-friendly technologies in construction, energy, water management, or industrial production and transportation. Scientific innovation is what is required, especially through legislative action, to change this behavior of how we are polluting the air. So this was just a brief understanding or introduction to what is air pollution in India. So with respect to this, we have brought about certain initiatives, certain measures in order to deal with air pollution in India. So we'll just briefly go through them one by one. So the first is National Air Quality Monitoring Program. The first is National Air Quality Monitoring Program. Now, when it comes to your National Air Quality Monitoring Program, in India, the Central Pollution Control Board has been executing a nationwide program of ambient air quality monitoring known as the National Air Quality Monitoring Program. So, the National Air Quality Monitoring Program in India is undertaken to determine the status and trends of ambient air quality. This is nothing but to determine the status and trends of ambient air quality to ascertain the compliance of your NAAQS, that is your National Ambient Air Quality Standards, to identify non-attainment cities, to understand the natural process of cleaning in the atmosphere, and obviously to undertake preventive and corrective measures. So this is as part of your National Air Quality Monitoring Program. For example, annual average concentration of sulfur oxide levels are within the prescribed National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So this was determined as part of your National Air Quality Monitoring Program. So National Air Quality Monitoring Program will determine the status, the level of pollutants in the atmosphere within India's territory to determine whether we are complying with the required standards. Okay, now as I told you that sulfur oxide levels have been brought down. So how has this brought down? This was determined as part of your monitoring program. So this reduction from earlier levels was due to the various measures which were taken, including the use of CNG in public transport in India and the reduction of sulfur in diesel and use of LPG instead of coal as a domestic fuel. So these were certain measures which were introduced in order to reduce pollution, and this reduction in pollution was determined through the National Air Quality Monitoring Program. So here we have few other certain things. Okay, so under this we have the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So what is this National Ambient Air Quality Standards? I'm sure you'd have read about NAAQS. This NAAQS is nothing but the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. The National Ambient Air Quality Standards were actually notified in the year 1982 and later revised in 1994 based on health criteria and land uses. So this National Ambient Air Quality Standards have been revised, and in 2009, 12 pollutants have been listed under this National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So I want you to know these 12 pollutants. What are these 12 pollutants? The 12 pollutants considered under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards are: 1. Sulfur dioxide. 2. Nitrogen dioxide. Particulate matter of size 10 microns. And then particulate matter of size 2.5 microns, particulate matter of size 10 and 2.5 microns, ozone, lead, carbon monoxide, arsenic, nickel, benzene, ammonia, and benzopyrene. These are the 12 pollutants under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards. So you have to know these 12 pollutants. What are the 12 pollutants under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards? Now, apart from the National Ambient Air Quality Standards, we have the National Air Quality Index. Now, the National Air Quality Index was launched by the Prime Minister in 2015, starting with 14 cities to disseminate air quality information in such cities. So, the Air Quality Index has 6 categories of air quality. That is good, satisfactory, moderately polluted. So, 6 categories under the National Air Quality Index are good, satisfactory, moderately polluted, poor, very poor, and severe. This air quality index is along with distinct color scheme so that it is very easy for everybody to understand the quality of air in their cities. So apart from categorizing them into good, satisfactory, moderately polluted, poor, very poor and severe, there's also a color coding scheme associated with it. So it is very easy for everybody to understand. So each of these categories is associated with likely health impacts. Now, in order to determine the air quality index of a city, 8 pollutants are considered over here. So apart from the 12 pollutants over here, from the 12 pollutants under the National Ambient Air Quality, 8 pollutants are considered to determine the National Air Quality Index. So out of these 12, you'll have to consider the particulate matter 10 and 2.5, that is of microns, nitrogen oxide, sulfur, nitrogen dioxide, sulfur dioxide, ozone, carbon monoxide, ammonia and lead. So out of the 12 pollutants under the National Ambient Air Quality Standards, these 8 pollutants are considered to determine the National Air Quality Index in major cities around India. Okay, so I want you to remember these 12 pollutants, and out of these 12 pollutants, what are the 8 pollutants considered to determine the National Air Quality Index in major cities of India? Apart from this, we have the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981. Now, as part of your homework, I want you to read about this Air Prevention and Control Pollution Act 1981. Now, I'll not be discussing about this particular act. I want you to read about it. Now, I want you to understand what are the salient features of the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act. How does it contribute? How does it help to reduce and bring down prevention and bring down air pollution? And how does it help in preventing air pollution? And how does it help in controlling air pollution in India? So, this as a part of your homework, I want you to read more about the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981. So I hope you have had some understanding about air pollution. What are the different aspects of air pollution which are actually important when it comes to your preparation for your UPSC or your KPSC or any other examination? So I hope you've had a better understanding, a thorough or overall understanding when it comes to air pollution. Obviously, this is not exclusive. You'll have more information regarding air pollution. What is more important is current affairs when it comes to air pollution. So I'm requesting you to please read more news, to read more about air pollution in terms of the latest news reports and articles about air pollution and what we are doing, how do we deal with air pollution when it comes to India especially, and also at the international level. So thank you very much. If you do have any doubts, please do write to us in the comment section. Thank you.